new to the shit, the video shit.
I'm
so.
Good to go.
The street corner soapbox. The street corner soapbox with Falso and Willin. Podcast takeover. We're making a killing. Music to nightlife. Debauchery and street news. Serving it hot. We are some street dudes. Movies and mayhem. The craziest guests. Word from chaos. Get it off our chest. Rhode Island, worldwide. Dark corners in all places. Speak how we live. Radio show. Smoking aces. Ladies and gents, for the people we're talking. Take the show on the road. Right where you're walking. Yeah.
That's right, ladies and gentlemen. Street Corner Soapbox Podcast coming to you live.
That's right, boys and girls. Street Corner Soapbox. I am back with my brother, Lord Willin.
Yo, what's cracking?
What's going on? What's up? What's up?
How much, man? We're here today with my brother, Don Capria. What's going on, bro?
What's up? What's up?
What's going on, gentlemen? How you doing?
How much, brother? How you doing? How you feeling?
Good. Just, you know, dodging snowflakes and
yeah,
two different ways. But, you know, it's winter. And now, hopefully, the spring will be here and we can get back to the normalcy.
No doubt. You're out in New York these days, right?
I'm in New York, Westchester County.
Cool, man. How's everything out there with the COVID?
It's much better than New York City. I was in Astoria like about a year before I moved back here. I'm from here and very glad about the move. You know, the way that things have been handled in the city, with the politics of the whole thing are kind of shameful. So here, you know, we didn't have the same type of lockdown restrictions as they did in the city. So it's not normal, but at least you can walk into a restaurant. And, you know, the interesting thing is that no one's ever really weighed out the whole fact that, like, well, if you have a 50% capacity restaurant here and there's not more cases here per capita, then why don't you give 50% everywhere? Because a restaurant is only so big, right? So it's not like, you know, there's a lot of people like, oh, there's 8 million people in New York City. Well, 8 million people aren't fitting into the restaurant at 50% capacity. That's why you do the, you know, the smaller thing. So I feel bad. I have, you know, obviously we both have a lot of the same friends and, you know, our guys were a lot of them in the live music business.
Oh, yeah.
I come from the music business. This is another reason why I've been, you know, feeling blessed lately. I left artist management 2 years ago to go back to writing full time. And, you know, when you work in music, especially in the management side of things, you know, you work off the artist's income and the artist's income is, you know, 60% touring.
Right. You get out at the right time.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, what do you see happening as far as, I mean, I hope, you know, as a fan and as an artist, I hope we can get back to some kind of show situation in the sooner than later. What do you think is going to happen?
Yeah. I mean, it all starts with the underground, you know, so there has to be a movement. And it'll probably be an illegal movement of sorts.
Yeah.
You know, laws are written to be broken. So, you know, and that's what we've seen cyclical. And you know, I mean, I think like the Prohibition era is a good way to kind of look at what's coming up for us. So I think that it'll start with a lot of the underground scenes that are already used to this kind of, you know, rebellion. It'll probably start with the trap movement, I think. I think they're the most rebellious and powerful movement right now. And I don't think these kids are going to sit still and not play live shows for their fans.
Yeah.
You know, the benefit to having everybody locked down from the artist side is that, you know, and I've given this advice and direction to a lot of the artists that I still talk to, is you get to create way more than you've ever done. You know, this is the
time true.
You buckle down and you just get a whole bunch of content. And hopefully it's like the gym where you shed some fat on the way you were making music and you get a little bit better at it. Because some people just get into a routine of making music and they're not really putting out their best stuff because it's kind of a content race that's out there right now. You know, who could get it out first and fastest is where music has gone. So, you know, hopefully this creates a higher bar that everyone had to sit home and create music. And, you know, it's white noise after a while, right? There's just so much stuff coming out.
Oh yeah.
So what do we pay attention to? So I think, you know, maybe we'll even see a new genre spawned or, but hopefully an underground movement, you know, the young movement, because the young people don't care. They're not, you know, you're gonna write me a ticket for doing a show with a bunch of my friends. Like, they don't care.
Yeah.
And they shouldn't care because laws are made to be broken.
You don't think we're going to see any like hardcore or punk shows popping up on the underground too?
Yeah. I mean, but we know that that's, you know, that's that kind of a movement.
Yeah. Yeah.
I don't know if that will be the movement that will come out on top as far as the new underground. It's an old underground, punk and hardcore. I don't really know the climate of the newer hardcore bands that are coming up now, if they have the same velocity as these trap kids do. Mm-hmm. It just seems like trap is just, you know, it's formidable. It's just not going anywhere and it's not slowing down. And there's so many kids that want to do it. And it's, you know, musically, it's like the lowest fruit on the tree. You know, anyone can do it. You can have about, you know, 14 minutes experience and you can step into a box. You know how to work the auto tune and, you know, the beats are very simplistic. It's kind of like punk in that respect, right? Like trap only has a few instruments that he uses. Well, punk only had a few instruments. That he used. You know, the drum set was small. The guitar sounded a certain way. The bass did. And the mic was just distorted. So I think that, if, you know, it's kind of one and the same, except for trap has this momentum and all these young kids that just kind of like love what that's doing right now. I haven't seen that. I hope punk and hardcore, you know, continue to strive and grow, because, you know, I came from that and I knew it was a really valid music genre. You know, there was a lot of people that were great players. You know, that's something that I miss when I hear new music, is I miss talent, because a lot of the stuff, it lacks that, you know, unfortunately, because it's in sales, it doesn't have what it, you know, you'd see like, oh my God, that guy's the best drummer I've ever seen at a show, or the best bass player, or the best front man. And, you know, we're lacking that right now because everything's on this MP3. You know, and it's the music video, with the music videos, smoke and mirrors, right? Like I shoot music videos, you know, the music video is like, all right, we're going to make you look like the best thing on the planet, when we know that you're not. But, you know, it's not that you're not the best thing on the planet, but you make a music video to give this, you know, super visual to a band and really make them look iconic. Cause that's the ultimate goal, is to like, to become an icon where you could just be like, and I hate to use a powerful source, but like a Drake, where he could literally just like pick up his phone and play a beat in the background and rap, and it's going to be a hit because he's iconic and everyone is just eating up everything that the guy does, you know. So once you reach a certain level of stardom, you know, you got nothing to worry about.
Speaking of which, why don't you get into your background about how you got into music and the music scene and everything else?
Yeah, I mean, going all the way back, I got into music because I was a drummer, and I did the whole band thing when I was in like fourth grade. I was obsessed. My older cousin, I think, is the human that got me into music, because he had a guitar and he had all these posters all over his wall, and it was like Rush and Led Zeppelin and Def Leppard, and I was like examining all the stuff that he had. So that's where I learned about music, was through him. And when I saw Neil Peart, I forget what it was, but it was like a music video or something. You know, it may have been something from Moving Pictures. And I saw this drum set, which was like bigger than my bedroom. I was just like, holy shit, I want to be a drummer. So started off with cookie cans and tins. And I played drums all throughout high school. And then after high school, I started playing in bands. I played in a band from New York called Blindside, not the European one. And then I ended up jumping into Scarhead, mm-hmm. after Goat left. And I toured with Scarhead, and I didn't go back into Scarhead after 2001, but always stayed close with Ezak.
Right.
And then I think it was around that time that Ezak was like, I'm done with hardcore. I was working as a music manager, and I always loved Ezak. Ezak's iconic to me. You know?
Shout out to our brother, Lord Ezak, Dan Diablo.
Shout out to Lord Ezak. So sure. I was working with a bunch of guys doing some hip hop stuff, and G-Fella.
Shout out to G-Fella,
shout out to Grizz.
Yes, sir.
Eddie and Chicky and Kitty Cat and Drastic and all these artists I was working with at UW. We wanted to sign Ezak. He was different, you know, and I wanted to treat Ezak into a new, I wanted to rebrand him. And that's when Lord Ezak became Danny Diablo. I think the first record that was done, he'll correct me because he's really good at details, might've been the Shop Blockers record they did.
Okay.
With Shifty and those guys, Suck on My Gun.
Yep.
That might have been the first Danny Diablo cut. And then the most famous one, which was one of the earliest cuts that happened, was on the Transplants record, Dream.
Yeah, great album too, by the way.
Great album, one of my favorite albums. So we started branding him with that style. And we were talking to a bunch of different producers, everyone from Dante Ross to Tim Armstrong. And we built like a street CD in 2002, put that out. And then Travis was really interested in putting out his record. So, and then I took a departure from everything for a little while. I got into writing heavily. Danny ended up putting out that music, and I was swore to myself I was never getting back into the music business. I was like, I'm just going to write. I'm going to direct, you know, no more. And I ended up doing management again for like another 5-6 years, which, you know, it's a gift and a curse. I love working in the music business, but I also really enjoy writing and directing. And I feel like that might be where I'm going to end up and not as a music manager.
What made you transition from being a drummer to getting into music management?
I think it was a financial thing. I think I came home from tour and I was like, you know, looking at what I had and then looking at the band splits and then talking to other bands about their band splits. I used to talk with Jamie Hatebreed, shout out to him, a lot about the business side of music because he was always very business minded. And I just started to notice that like the band goes out and plays every show for 60 days, 35 days, whatever it is. The manager doesn't go. He hits a couple of shows, but the manager gets 15 to 20%. Which is about the same payout for each one of the members. So I'm like, wait a minute, I can sit home, jump on calls, do promotion, help set up other gigs for them. And they go out every night and do all the hard work. And I'm going to get paid the same amount of
members. Work smarter, not harder, right?
It sounds pretty good, you know? So I actually ended up managing Scarhead for a long time. So I did the Revival record, which was, shout out to Lawrence Custer's. Yep. We did a deal with Ice Cream Records. And we put out Drugs, Music, Sex. So I kind of exec peed that whole album. I shot the music videos for that album.
No problem.
That was when, you know, Danny, you know, Danny's like one of these what's in front of my face type of dudes. And he's very passionate about, you know, what's going on in the immediacy. And, you know, at the time, it was easier to talk to him about doing hardcore again, you know, and then since then he's gone back to visit Crown of Thorns and he's done more heavy stuff. So, but there was a time where he just wasn't, I think he just didn't want to do it anymore. You know, the passion was gone for him. And he really, he's, you know, he's been a hip hop head his whole life. So he was really interested in cutting records like that. And I don't know if it's easier, but it might be, I think it is, you know, I think that's one of the reasons why is the assembly and keeping a band together and not having to replace members. You don't have to, you know, hip hop artists don't have to worry about that. Like, oh, where am I get my, you know, they don't have the insecurity feeling of like, you know, what are people going to say when I replace my drummer, when I replace my guitars, when I play, you know, you step out on that stage, there might be, you know, it's like Mortal Kombat, your strength rate right now might not be the same with these guys behind you as the guys that you know were like the original members of a band.
Yeah.
And singers have to suffer that fate. Other band members have to suffer that fate. And I think, you know, Ezak really saw that like the band wasn't the band that he had had before and he stopped doing it altogether. But I'm glad that he brought it back because when he gets in the studio and he makes records, they're dope, you know?
You did some work with G-Fella too, right? For a while?
For a while, yeah. We, him and Grizz, they had a production deal. This is way back. It was called UW was the name of their clique. And I convinced those guys, this is prior to Napster. This is like 1999, I think. But I had convinced those guys like, yo, you should just turn it into a label. Stop. They're pretty. They had, I remember I used to go listen to records and these guys had hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of records with all these different artists they were working with and none of them were out. And I'm just like, you know, what are you waiting for? Like, let's get to it. You know, like you don't have to wait until someone gives you a blessing. Like we can go, you know, and I had been hearing stories about the guys down in the South from like Master P and Cash Money guys who are like, they're selling CDs to hip hop heads. They're going, they're playing live shows and doing that. So I kind of came in and started GMing their stuff. And they were working with Queen Latifah at the time, Shaquem Comprary. And we were discussing the potential of getting a label situation through EMI, who they had to deal with. So we were going to be an imprint off of Flavor Unit and EMI. And that was like right before a lot of stuff in my life personally started happening where I just left the music business altogether. And then got into writing.
Talk about your first scripted project, Westchester. That was, you did a TV pilot for that?
Yeah, I wrote a whole bunch of scripts and had a few friends that were working in production. And I met like some really low level producers, awesome guys that were, you know, kind of hyping up my work. And everyone just fell in love with this one pilot I wrote. It was basically about my life story. It was about me as a music manager in Westchester, managing an Italian rapper who was G-Fella, and then managing a Black rapper that was from the projects. And it was the clash between those. You know, you got your Italian boys, and you know, you've got this kinship that you've had your whole life, and then you've got this new artist who's on the rise. So I wrote the piece, and then we went out and raised money at one of the hardest times to raise money. It was during the financial crisis, 2008. And we ended up losing a ton of money. So we shot like a super trailer. We shot the whole pilot. We never edited the whole pilot. And then we put out the super trailer. I did a couple of deals with some good producers. I got an option twice, and we were like at the doors to HBO, you know, like ready to go in and make this thing a TV show. I was already picking out what building I was going to buy in the Lower East Side and what kind of car I was going to be driving. So, but we didn't end up getting it across the finish line. At that time, there was only about 7 networks that would play a show like that. And now there's about 22.
Right. So,
the climate was different to go out and pitch a TV show, me being an unknown writer, director. I kind of ran the show on the script, but they're never going to give, you know, multi-million dollar budgets to a person like me. And we couldn't land a showrunner at the time, which is a very specific job that TV looks for to make a continuing series.
I think it would have been an interesting show because it's a different part of New York. I mean, it's right outside the city. So it's, you know, kind of part of the city anyway. I think that would have been dope, man.
I've never had anybody watch that trailer and
really
praise, you know.
Yeah.
And I'm thankful for that, you know, because it even though it wasn't the success that I wanted it to be or dreamed it to be, it opened up a lot of doors for me as a director. They took me serious as a writer. So, you know, that project will always hold a special place in my heart. And it's an intellectual property. So who knows, maybe, you know, 4 years from now, someone's like, hey, we want to revisit this.
Yeah.
I'll say one thing, the few network meetings I did make. So this is in 2009 when we were out for pitch. The few network meetings I made, the executive said that we love the show. We just don't think people are going to be interested in a show that has a musical backdrop. 2 years later, you had boom, Power, Empire, Nashville, Atlanta. they were just coming out. And I'm sitting back at that time. I was writing the Colombo book, but you know, man, was I getting salty.
I bet, man. Like, you just, like, if you would have waited a couple more years, you probably would have been on.
I wanted all their cell phone numbers and just call them. Like, they don't want to show with a musical backdrop, huh? Okay. Your daughter's watching Power right now, huh? She's addicted. Okay. Seeing her on Instagram or whatever, you know, like, but you can't, you know, you can't do that. You just got to hold. I learned at that time, you know, that I was a little bit ahead of the curve. So, you know, hopefully that would mean, you know, the stuff that I'm doing now, let it develop a little bit longer. I did a crime project over the whole COVID period that, you know, it's one of those projects where it's a true crime project. So,
oh yeah.
Yeah. It's one of those projects where it may take a few more years to develop it and get it. It's all set and ready to go. But now I'm more patient knowing that, like, you gotta wait until, you know, sometimes you gotta let the grass grow, you know, you cannot force this stuff. So
can you drop any hints on what it's about?
It's about some elite Jewish gangsters from the 1930s in Brooklyn.
Oh man, yeah, I look forward to that. I'm already interested.
Yeah, yeah. We'll talk on the side
about. Yeah, yeah, yeah. What made you get into writing in the first place?
When I was in like third or fourth grade, they had this program, and I'm sure every school's got it. It was called Gifted and Talented, and like I don't know what it was, but they handpicked a bunch of kids, and they were like, it was like an after school program. And I think there was like 2 or 3 different things that you could do. And one of them was writing. You had, you know, story. And I was like telling stories, listening to stories. So I was like, oh, I'm going to take the writing program. So I took the writing program. And I remember my first story that I ever wrote was about a kid that went with his friend's family to Egypt. They went to go into the pyramid. You were allowed to go into the pyramid. And this kid and his friend like pushed a stone in the pyramid, and they ended up going into like a secret passageway. And, you know, it was a total fantasy piece. And then like that same year, we got assignment in class to write a story for the newspaper about animal cruelty. And I wrote a story a little bit different. Everyone was like, oh, you got to treat your dog right and pet it and feed it. And I did this story with pictures about like not hunting and like you shouldn't kill animals. And I wasn't even a vegan. I just was like, I don't think you should be out in the woods shooting deer. Right. So I did this whole piece, front page of the paper. I won a $500 gift certificate to Toys R Us. That was my first paycheck. So I was like, well, I'm a writer.
So there you go, man. Yeah.
I've always continued to chase that, you know?
Yeah, man. Well, you know, speaking of writing, let's talk about your book, Colombo. I don't think it's, yeah, I can see that. Colombo, how'd you get involved in that? Tell us about that process.
So I was working on Westchester. I was in an edit and I got a phone call from a friend of mine and he was like, hey, you know, you had shown interest in this Joe Colombo story. And I had kind of talked to a bunch of people about wanting to do something with Joe Colombo, but I was told, look, his family's still alive. You need a blessing. So it's probably not possible at this point. And then this guy calls me up and says, these guys are doing a story on Joe Colombo. They're looking for a writer. Are you interested? I was like, yeah, of course. So I get a phone call from this guy, private number, very mysterious. And he's just asking me a million questions about me. And there was some information online about Westchester at the time. So they knew I was an Italian American writer from New York. So this guy was like, all right, well, how about you do lunch with me, Joe Colombo's son, Joe Colombo's grandson, on Sunday at 10 o'clock. I was like, let's do it. So I drove to this diner in upstate New York and we sat at a big round table and it was the driver. It was Joe Colombo's son, Anthony. It was Joe Colombo's grandson, Anthony Jr. And this guy, Ray, big shout out to Ray Vanacore, who landed me the job. So they asked me, you know, they were grilling me. They were like, you know, what do you know about my father? And what do you know about the story? And what do you know about the FBI? And I had read about Joe in like five or six different books. I was always an aficionado. I was always reading these crime books, especially. Mm-hmm. In New York. So I was never impressed with how people were kind of copy and pasting the same three paragraphs about Joe Colombo in every book, then changing adjectives. I was like, no one's investigating this guy. And he has the most dynamic life out of all the five family leaders. You know, with the Italian American Civil Rights League,
right,
on the circle, and you know, he came from. They all come from nothing, but like his mother and his father got killed. His mother left for California, so I impressed Anthony with what little knowledge I did have, and especially the fact that I felt his death was a conspiracy and unsolved. I never believed the Joe Gallo story, so I remember getting the phone call, and it was like, "Yo, you got the job," and that was, you know, from Ray. They had an agent at the time. His name was Mickey Freiberg. So they didn't want me to do a screenplay. They wanted me to write the book. And I'd never written a book before. So I got the job, kind of. I had to write a 40-page treatment and turn it into the agent. So who was going to be, you know, shopping it to a publisher. And I wrote that. And he said, the kid can write. So it had a chapter built into it and the basic story and players and how it's going to all unfold. And then I spent the next few years of my life interviewing Anthony and writing this book, which was, you know, the hardest thing that I've ever done and probably the best thing that I've ever done. And, you know, so that too has opened up a lot of doors for me as a writer. I haven't written another book since then, just because I really have a passion for filmmaking. And, you know, the book is the first step for the intellectual property, then a screenplay, and then you shoot the film. So I'm kind of skipping the book and getting to screenplays, but the Colombo book is definitely something that, even as I was writing it, putting in the vignettes in each chapter, I'm envisioning this thing playing out as a film.
So is there a movie in the works?
There's nothing in the works, but you know, we would openly take calls. In the beginning, when we first dropped it, we spoke to a bunch of different producers. It's a timing thing. I think, you know, I saw recently Martin Scorsese, he did The Irishman and he put Joe Colombo in the book and the scene where Joe Colombo gets shot in Columbus Circle. Mm-hmm. He's been in popular culture in a few different ways. There was actually a whole movie done on it back in the 70s. So I think someone's going to pick up my book one day and they're going to read it and they're going to see these vignettes and they're going to be like, wait a minute, Frank Sinatra, Nelson Rockefeller, Sammy Davis Jr., Joe Gallo, what was the guy from Jersey? Sam the Plumber. Mm-hmm. There's just so many stories with Joe, these first person stories with him. And even I think, you know, the civil rights stuff, you know, Joe's group was being investigated and being attacked by COINTELPRO. And this is something that a lot of people don't even know about, but now I just watched a movie the other night on HBO called Judas and the Black Messiah.
I've heard about that.
So it's must see. So that movie is directly about the COINTELPRO operation to destroy the Black Panthers and the killing of Fred Hampton. And it happened. It's not, you know, people today are very interesting with their knowledge of history and what they complain about. And, you know, that happened to the extent of there was a civil suit filed. They got paid millions of dollars because it was proven that he was a target of the FBI and killed by the FBI. You know, there's so many interesting stories about our government. And I laugh at people who are like, oh, the government wouldn't do that. I'm like, no. There's paperwork that shows they wouldn't have done that before.
They certainly would. They certainly have.
Yeah, like you really think that like they look at other countries differently than their own? Like if they have a way to, you know, disrupt power and to give themselves more power and to keep people, you know, the divide and conquer tactic, it's like it's now more than ever. You know, it started, you know, 40, 50, 60, 70 years ago. It's seeded in everything from the women's lib movement to the civil rights movement to now the gender movement. And you saw the Proud Boys guy came out. He's an informant. This neo-Nazi leader is an informant. They were doing this with Weather Underground and in the 1960s on the college campuses. They were planting people within organizations and making that person turn people within the organization into radicals through speech and through psychological manipulation. It's not rocket science. You know, you probably have friends that have convinced you to do some dumb shit before.
Oh yeah, you know a couple of them.
and that's all it is. You know, it's happening. And for the book, I investigated COINTELPRO. I interviewed this ex-CIA agent. And we discussed, you know, the shooting and we discussed the shooting of political leaders. And, you know, you've got a similar style story from JFK to Martin Luther King to Bobby Kennedy to one of Joe's good friends that he was aligning himself with, which was Meyer Kahane. So there was all these different leaders that have all suffered the same fate as Joe. They were killed. You know, you shoot and you kill someone, but you also kill their ideology.
Yeah.
That's the thing is that when someone becomes iconic, like Joe Colombo or like Kennedy or like Martin Luther King, the bullet doesn't kill the human. It kills the ideology. It really destroys the movement. And they know that.
Yeah. Joe Colombo has a very interesting story. You know, obviously going from organized crime to heading a civil rights movement. How do you think he was able to pull that off? Because in that world of organized crime, you know, you kind of want to be in the shadows. And I don't think, I mean, you talk about it in the book, but not everyone was happy with what he was doing.
Yeah, I mean, well, how did he pull off the duality was because he got the power first. It's kind of like a politician. You don't run on like all these good things you're going to do for society. You get in and then when you have the power, then you fix those things. So Joe and the Civil Rights League, that was always a passion of his. Many people don't know. He was the funder and the person that was actually behind AID, which was the first defamation league that the Italians had. I think it came out around the same time as the Sons of Italy. But Joe could not be the leader back then, so he just funded it.
Okay.
When things were happening and Joe was upset with them, he used to fight with them constantly throughout the 60s because they weren't doing anything. They were all just taking a paycheck and having dinner events. And Joe looked at that like, you know, you guys are lazy bastards. You're just like politicians. So when his son got arrested by the FBI, that's when Joe was like, that's it. I'm starting the Italian American Civil Rights League. I'm not going to run it, but I'm going to put someone in it. And I hate to say, you know, Nat Marconi was a puppet of his, but he was his fingers. You know, he did put people, he put his own son there. He put people that he could trust. You know, we're not going to call them puppets. We're going to say these were the people that he knew would execute his ideas, you know, with efficiency. So when he put that league together, a lot of people looked at it like he just did it because his son got arrested. No, that was the straw that broke the camel's back. He had been doing it for so long, they just weren't doing anything. So he needed someone that was going to be effective. And as for the gangster side of the whole thing, that was the spiral that started, you know, turning his life into a disaster because, mm-hmm. you know, from his mentor, Carl Gambino, to the Lucchese family, all of the leaders did not want this extra attention.
Right.
Joe got stubborn enough to the point where he was like, look, I'm on the sidelines. I'm going to do some news interview. And it ended up costing him his life, whether it was through them or through the government. But still, him choosing to try to pursue both those avenues at the same time, you know, ultimately cost him his life. And, you know, from the side of the story that I learned was from his son, and his son had spoke numerous times to Carl Gambino after the shooting. Joe was going to step down that day. That was the biggest point. It was the biggest takeaway from all this that I had, was that all of the guys that were involved in organized crime from New York, all the leaders knew that Carl and him had to sit down, and Carl told him, like, listen, you know, this is it. And Joe accepted that. He was like, I'm going to step down completely. I'm going to let these guys run this organization. I think he had to do a small sentence for the perjury on a real estate application. That was going to kind of be a break in to everything. So his plans to leave the league were already in place. And that's why, you know, I never felt it was an OC hit, because the OC knew, okay, we don't have to get rid of this guy. He's going to fall into the shadows with this, you know?
Yeah, and he might have earned enough respect too to be able to, you know, step back from that and still continue doing what else, you know, the other things that he was doing.
Yeah, but it was definitely the league itself was just, you know, the attention and everything. Whether it did good, you know, personally, it did so much harm to him and to his family, you know, the tragedy of losing him. But what he did with the world, and I think I just put a post out yesterday or today with Joe at a meeting. You know, he was at, you know, the Park Sheraton Hotel every Wednesday night. They would do these group meetings. And I think about all the things that we have in place today that are so beneficial to people, like GoFundMe, right? You know, back then, there's tons and tons of stories that Anthony would tell me about, like someone coming into this meeting place on a Wednesday night, and it would be like, you know, someone from Middle Village, and they would get their chance to speak, and he'd say, listen, you know, my father, he's handicapped, and he's got to go to the doctor this many times a week, but he's in a wheelchair and we can't get him there. And we're having a lot of problems. This guy has a van. We're trying to raise money so that we can quit this lift. That'll put my father in the lift and into the van. And this guy's willing to drive him up. And they raised money that night. Like they got him wherever it was, like $4,000 or something. They went around the room, got checks the next day from people who said they were going to write. And this was constant. You know, one of the stories I put in the book was one that was always near and dear to me, was when the 69 Corona houses were going to get demolished in Queens because they wanted to put a school there. Those were all Italian. It was an Italian American strip. And they were all like, you know, we don't want to lose our home, so you could build the school. You got this empty lot, this adjacent lot. You could build the school right there. The city planners have already said that they could build a school there. So there was a lawyer that was fighting for all these guys, but he couldn't. He's going into the city hall. He's fighting with politicians all on his own. He's got, you know, 6, 7, 8, 10 families that are fighting with him, and nothing's happening. So he went to a Wednesday night meeting. He pleaded his case when he got his chance to speak. And Colombo and the Italian American Civil Rights League gave that dude 1,000 guys to march down the city hall with pickets. And they went to city hall and demanded that this get overturned. And eventually it did. That lawyer was Cuomo, Mario Cuomo, becoming the governor of New York. He, at the time, he was just a young, you know, a young lawyer fighting for the rights of these Queens residents. So the story has so much that we didn't even explore from the civil rights stuff that happened all within less than 24 months from the time that he started that league. You know, they broke ground on a hospital in Brooklyn. They broke ground on a kids camp in upstate New York. It was just so much stuff that those guys were doing that never really made it out because the news media is only interested in murder and death and destruction.
Right, of course. And, now, do you think there was... Oh, go ahead.
I was going to say, and we can't forget they love contagions.
Yeah, oh, cool. We know that. We've been living that the last year, but we know that. Do you think there was more oppression against Italian Americans than what maybe people realized during that time period?
Way more. Yeah, than what people realize? Yeah, 100%. There is... It with the Italian Americans and civil rights and them getting themselves out of poverty and into the suburbs, it is a very muted situation. You know, you don't really hear about it, but there is a plethora of Hollywood actors who have fake last names because when they came here, and I take it myself, so I'm second generation and I don't speak fluent Italian because my mom doesn't speak fluent Italian because they were taught in the household to learn English and only English. Mm-hmm. They weren't allowed to speak Italian because they knew the persecution. And you know, during the heavy immigration from the late 1800s all the way up until like the 1940s, I think when it really stopped, there was a lot of persecution against Italian Americans. They were treated very poorly, and the parents just didn't want that for their kids. So, you know, the work ethic of them was, you know, it's an immigrant work ethic. It's not just the Italians that did that. The Irish, the Dutch, the Germans, everyone that's come with the Chinese, and now we're seeing it from South America. Mm-hmm. So the work ethic of an immigrant is impossible to duplicate. You know, you're just not going to get it because they don't have the same opportunities in their countries. And, you know, when we talk about classism and racism and the social gap that happens between us, Italians didn't really promote all the struggle that they went through, but they went through it and came out on the other side. You know, there's a lot of successful Italian businessmen. They were very much into community, which is always where I've always stood too, is like, you can fix a lot of the problems by fixing your house and fixing your neighbor's house and fixing their neighbor's house. And then all of a sudden you have a strong community versus a lot of people's ideology because of the internet, because they're so, you know, they think they're actually in touch with Florida. Right now it's Texas. You know, there's so many people talking about Texas, and I'm like, you don't even fucking live there. Like, what are you, you're going to start talking about how they're going to fix the power. What are you, an electrician, an engineer? Now you're in the oil business. Or so, you know, we have this new, you know, virtue signaling where we can fix the world. But the truth is, the Italians knew, look, we're not going to fix racism. We're not going to fix the persecution. We're not going to fix our wages. What we have to do is create value. And they created a value. They were stonemasons. They owned flower shops. They were great at making bread. They were good at serving food. You know, guys didn't become millionaires because of making pizza, even though everyone loves pizza. It was all the other things that they were doing that got them out of poverty, you know?
Yeah, I mean, being a non-Italian, but growing up kind of, you know, in an Italian neighborhood, I mean, I've had a lot of influence from Italian culture. So I definitely understand what you're saying.
Yeah, there's quite a few books on it. I think Jacob Riis had one of the best books. It's called How the Other Half is Living. And that was, and there's another one called 5 Centuries of the Italian American Experience. So there's a lot of books that detail events, lynchings, Sacco and Vanzetti, which is kind of up. I don't know if you know that one. That was up.
I don't.
Okay, so that's up by you. That was these two Italian Americans that were wrongfully convicted of a murder and they were sentenced to death. And that
really?
That caused a massive uprising in the Northeast when it happened. Bombings. I mean, it was serious.
What year was that?
Sacco and Vanzetti. Thank God for Google. Sacco.
Jamie, look that up.
1920.
Okay. All right.
1920.
Yeah, I'm gonna have to look into that.
It's called Braintree, Massachusetts.
Oh yeah. I know Braintree, not far.
Yep.
Yeah. Talk about your short film, Eulogy.
Eulogy was a passion project that I did. It was, you know, independent. I have a film company, so we shoot music videos and projects. So it had been a while since I had shot Westchester. I had just come out of finishing the Colombo book. Our release for the Colombo book got delayed. So I started this project about brotherhood, and it started off as Irish. I didn't want to do Italian. I was like, everyone's going to just be like, all this guy does is Italian stuff, you know? So I was thinking about all these different enclaves, these like little nook neighborhoods that I knew about. And there was an Irish one in the Bronx that I really liked going there, because you could feel it when you arrive there, you know, you're just like, you know, you're around a lot of Irish people.
And what neighborhood is that?
Van Cortlandt Park, and then McLean off Yonkers. So okay. Those are very Irish neighborhoods, Irish settled, just like Greenpoint, Brooklyn's all Polish, right?
Yes, right.
So, but then my best friend, shout out to Leon, he's Albanian, and I grew up around a lot of Albanians coming from Westchester, New York, and I always loved their culture too. You know, like I was always very interested in people's culture. So I would always go with him down to the Bronx to this building that his family was a part of, and I just loved it. It was like 80% Albanians in this building. And like, you could feel it. You thought you were in, like, could have put this building in Albania. It was just so interesting. So I did a story, and at the core of it is about two brothers, one brother who goes away for the other brother's murder. And that actually comes from the Persico brothers. So
okay.
Ali Boy Persico went to prison for a person that Carmine Persico murdered, because Ali Boy was younger. Carmine was about to get made. And they thought they're just going to give him 6 years, you know, like, don't worry about it. I'll do this for you. You go get made, go make money. You're the bigger guy. And they ended up giving him like almost 20 years for the murder. But the question that I had asked myself was like, you know, what would you do for a friend? What would you do for your brother? Would you give him your kidney? Would you loan him money? Would you do it? How about going to prison for him for a crime that he committed so that he can go live the rest of his life in peace? And that's what the story is at its core. But what happens is the brother that's in prison serving time, the brother that was home in the street ended up getting so fucked up with guilt that he kills himself. Oh. So now this guy's in prison doing time for a murder he didn't commit for a guy that just killed himself.
Wow. That sounds like a crazy story.
So I got a good buddy of mine, Kaves.
Yeah, shout out to Kaves. Lordz of Brooklyn, add money. What's up?
Yeah, I love Kaves. He's one of the best, and he's just a renaissance man. He does a little bit of everything, but he's amazing at everything that he does. And he had been doing some acting, so I pulled him in for the lead, and playing the role of his brother was Federico Castelluccio, another good buddy of mine, another painter who was playing Furio on The Sopranos. That's how most people know him for that.
Yeah, yeah.
But he's an amazing, amazing painter. Shout out to Federico.
Now, did you get that movie? You got it in a bunch of like festivals and things like that, like short film festivals?
Yep. We won at Queens World Film Fest. We put it in a few festivals. And then recently, I think it was this year, it got released finally. There wasn't a lot of channels to release shorts, but Shorts TV started by picking up all the Oscar nominations, and they just started signing more and more films. So they created their own little network. It's not on every cable network yet. It's on like Dish. It's on like all these kind of offshoot ones. I don't even have cable. So I didn't even see it yet via the TV, but it's on Shorts TV this year.
Okay.
And I think there's an app for that too, like shorts.tv, but I'm going to do like a live stream on the film page. I think IGTV or something will allow me to do that, where I could like upload it's a small film. It's like 13 minutes long.
Oh, okay. Oh, all right. I was thinking like maybe half hour or something. Okay. No, so it's really short.
The new one that I just did, not to jump forward, but
yeah,
I just finished doing a horror short with this young actress here from my neighborhood, and that's 31 minutes long. So I think the pacing of horror is just, you know, I wrote it was like 21 pages. I'm like, oh, this will be a 22-minute movie, 23-minute movie. All of a sudden, give me back the first cut, and we're still editing it now, but it was 32 minutes. I was like, oh, shit, I guess it's going to be a 30-something minute movie.
So eventually Eulogy will be available for everyone to see, because I want to see it. I mean, I've been hearing about it for quite some time now, and I remember I asked you, I'm like, yo, where can I watch this? And I really look forward to, even, you know, to seeing it.
I'll get that live stream event happening to make sure that people could see it, because with the internet, like, we are our own channels now. So as long as I'm not like crossing wires with the people that have it right now, I don't think they're going to care. But then when it comes back, I'm starting to see more and more channels are picking up short film, which is awesome, because not everybody wants to invest an hour and a half into a movie or 2 hours into a movie. And there's just so many shorts that are out. You know, people have been doing shorts since the dawn of film. You know, mm-hmm. That's how George Lucas and Scorsese and everybody, you know, they don't have the money or the budget or the wherewithal to create a full feature at first. So they have these really great ideas, these stories. They want to give a great visual. So that's kind of where I was going with Eulogy. There is a larger story to be had. Like, if we were to turn it into a feature, for sure, I would love to. But it was kind of just like a, you know, a piece to get everybody familiar with these characters. And, you know, I hope more and more people see it, because I'd love to get back involved with that project.
Would you say like film shorts or like demos? Like Louis Lombardi had said to me when I wanted to get into acting, I talked to him and he said the way to go now is to make a bunch of film shorts and get them out there. And me and Rob here actually made one. We haven't released it yet. It's like a 2-minute thing. But do you think that's kind of like, you know, basically like a demo comparable to like putting out music?
100%. Yeah. It's like the commitment of a single versus an album, maybe. You know, you're going to show your style, you're going to showcase your talent. Hopefully there's some little arc to the character, or just an interesting ending, you know, like some kind of problem gets solved within the couple of minutes that you do it. But it's definitely that, you know, it's a calling card. It's a business card. You know, if someone asked me to see my work, I would definitely, you know, gear them towards Westchester or something. More recently, I did Abaddon with Mick from Omerta.
Yeah. 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 Tell us about that.
That project started right when I was about to I was losing a few artists. I was having a real rough time with the management game. It's definitely a shady, shady business. And it was at the point where I was just, the stress was more than the paycheck. So I was talking with Mick. I used to have a desk in the back of the Omerita offices. And he was just like, you know, you think you make a really great manager. He goes, but you're a better writer. When are you going to get back to writing? So he kind of put a bug in my ear and talked to me about how he wanted to get involved in something. He's like, look, you know, I'm in and I'll put some money in with you if you want to do a short, because if you could fit me into it. And he was really, you know, what I love about Mick is like, he's very non-egotistical about his approach to business. It was always the project first with him. He wasn't like, how many lines am I going to have? What am I gonna, you know, he just kind of gave me an idea. I took the idea. I reshaped the entire thing. I came back to him and he was just like, that's awesome. So we saw eye to eye on it from day one till even now. And we raised money to shoot a short and we filmed the whole short. We went into the dark because we didn't have money to edit it, but we made a trailer. We thought we were going to shop the trailer because it was the idea itself was to become a limited series. So the short was like a half of a pilot episode that we would eventually make a limited television series of like 10 episodes. So I went to go pitch it. I flew out to LA at this exact time last year. I was out there for like 2 weeks and the looming COVID from China. I wasn't even taking it seriously though. I was, my whole LA trip, I was prepping a horror film. I did a little read with some cast members. Like I wasn't even, COVID was just like SARS or whatever else I had
heard. Yeah, that's what I thought too.
Totally blocking it out. And I come back March, I forget what day it was. My birthday's the 19th. It was a few days before my birthday. And we got locked down on the 17th and all of a sudden the world, you remember that first lockdown. That was,
yeah, oh my God.
I know.
It was lights out. Like
no you toilet were, paper.
Nothing, you know, dude. No toilet paper. Yeah.
I remember calling my best friend Leon and just being like, you know, did you get toilet paper? Cause I might have to come stay with you for, no, I didn't care about toilet paper. What I really cared about was like the zeitgeist, like the whole spirit of the world, because the entire world was shut down and it was just, you could feel it. You could walk outside and you could hear all the way to China, to Italy and Hungary and all around the world. It was just silence. If you had thrown something, it would have went all the way around the world. Nothing's in the way. So with that, I started doing some meetings, talking to people about getting Abaddon pitched, and it was kind of lights out. Like a lot of the people that I knew in Hollywood were telling me like, look, the only thing that's going to come back when it does come back is all the signed A-list talent projects. I was like, anything that's new, they're just not going to invest money into because the climate is not there. But then I spoke to a friend of mine who works more back-end in streaming, and he's like, there's going to be a major gap in streaming content. So shoot whatever you can shoot cheap, because Hollywood's not going to know how to get that going again. They're not going to know how to get the $1 million and less budget movies up and running fast and get them out the door, and no one's going to be shooting for a while. So I put Abaddon on hold. I wrote this horror short called Anecdota, and that's the one that I just finished filming. It's about a 10-year-old girl trapped in an abandoned building a year after a pandemic has destroyed modern society. So this girl does like a found footage piece, and we're editing that one now. And then I think it was towards the end of the summer, I spoke to the original group of investors and this one producer about Abaddon, and he understood. He was very compassionate, and he you know, he's like, look, the world's crazy right now. He goes, but I think, you know, what you've heard from the streaming people is the same feedback I'm getting. He's like, what if we were to keep moving forward with Abaddon, but shoot a feature and shoot the pilot, but make it 2 hours long, put it up as a movie because there is a void in content. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we could do a deal with Netflix or Amazon or whoever would want to pick this piece up. So I'm writing right now with a co-writer with Peter Conti. Shout out to Peter Conti. And we're working on the full pilot right now. So the plan is to finish the pilot for Abaddon and then shoot it at the end of the summer.
Okay. So work in progress, but everyone should stay tuned for it.
Work in progress. I'm many works in progress.
I hear you, man. Me too. Incantation. That's another film project you were working on.
So that was to what was to be shot last year. I went to LA to meet with Tati McQuay, who is the lead character in that movie. I met her years ago through a music manager friend. My producer that I was managing, producer artist, produced an album for these young girls that were on Warner Brothers. They were called L2M. And Tati was one of the girls that was in the group. And these girls had a show. It was a Disney Plus show. So it was like, at the time it was on Disney YouTube. And I always would like see these girls, super talented. They were, I think at the time I first met them, and they were like 13, and they were like 14 when they were making their album. And their manager had a regular manager who I love, this woman, Hermione Ross, out of the UK. She was working for a bigger company out of Denmark. And these guys weren't really pushing them back into, they did stuff for the Lego movie. I think they were all characters in the Lego movie too, but they weren't pushing their acting. And I'm like, you know, I'm one of these guys that sees the music business as like a business going like this, and the film business, a business going like this. So, you know, Tati and I, we would kick it. And I really got along great with her mother. She was like really awesome day-to-day management mom. And we started kicking it. And Tati's, like I said, 14 years old, and she knew every horror movie. And I'm a horror movie buff. So I was like, we're going to do something together. So I had this script sitting for years. It was short, called Incantation. I wrote the feature out. I sent it to her mom. The mom's like, we're on board. Let's do it. So we started casting it. And I went out to LA to meet with my investor. It was a micro budget. My investor's in real estate, and he had a house on the market. And I went to the house, the biggest house I've ever been in my life. You could Google it, and you'll have a good time checking this thing out. Go to YouTube, Google Unica Bel Air, and look at the $100 million house, which is now marked down to $78 million. So it's a steal, guys.
Not bad. It's not bad, man. Yeah, I got a couple bucks. Let's get it.
I'm going to pick it up. So this guy named Dean Hallow built it, who I met through a friend of mine here, producer Anthony Carpenito, who I love, awesome guy. And he told me, he's like, the house is going on the market March 15th. He goes, it's probably going to take us a month to sell it. We will be shooting your film in the summer. I'm like, awesome, great, amazing. March 17th, COVID comes. Like I said, the house is still on the market. So
monkey wrench. Yeah, yeah. Fucked up a lot of plans for a lot of people, myself included.
You got to shift. You got to call the audible. You know, I'm a quarterback. I'm not a defense line, an offensive lineman. So like I call the audible, got right into, like I said, anecdota. I was just sitting in my office right here, and I'm just like, what am I going to do when nothing is happening? And that's when I knew the girl who was, I casted Bella in Abaddon. There's a scene, it's Mick's daughter actually. And when I met this girl, I was blown away. She screen tested through the roof. I took photos of her. I did like some exercises with her while we were taking photos. I had her do like repetition exercises, inflection exercises. And I'm like, this 11-year-old girl is smarter than me. You know, it's like, holy cow. So she did the scene in Abaddon, and it wasn't really difficult for her. She nailed it. She did amazing at it, but it was also monochrome. It was just, you know, she had to play this real low volume kind of scene, and it didn't show what this girl had. She was in Newsies at the time. So I was like, I know this girl could tackle something all by herself. So that's when I wrote the project about the girl trapped in a building all alone, doing these testimonials, telling people about her daily routine, about her life, about all the things she loves and what she hopes for. And we wrote it as like it was kind of like a memo of hope to all the young kids that were going through the pandemic. You know, I wanted to write something for them. So that question to me is like, mom and dad are going crazy over toilet paper. They're fighting with each other because they're both home now. You know, there's all this stuff happening. What am I supposed to do as a kid? And they think that's a problem. So I'm saying, okay, here's an anecdota. Your mom is dead. Your dad hasn't come back in 30 days, and you're living by yourself in an abandoned building, and this girl's surviving. So it was the notion that like, you don't have it that bad. And if it gets worse, you can make it through it. So we filmed it over the last like 4 or 5 weekends. She read, like I said, it was a 22-page script. She's on every single page with dialogue. So wow. She a lot of rehearsing, a lot of rehearsals in the building that we shot in, because there's like a little action sequence that happens. And, you know, she nailed it. We the project will get announced next week. Do you know Rue Morgue? You know the magazine?
No.
So there's like Fangoria and Rue Morgue, okay. Really popular, amazing horror magazines. So Rue Morgue is announcing our project next week. They came to set and did some behind the scenes. And Fangoria also came to set, which will do a full feature on the piece once we have our world premiere. Shout out to my producer, Paul Travers, who did Old 37. He's also a hardcore kid from up your way.
Cool.
Where, but he's in the Mass area, but not far from you. And Paul, I met through Cousin Joe. Cousin Joe and I were, you know, go to Black and Blue Bowl every year. we're hanging out, and you know, Cousins, he's just a, he's an energy connector, right?
Yeah, man. Hell yeah. Shout out to Cuz.
He's like, you know what? You got to meet Paul Travers. He's like, you know Paul Travers? Paul. So he takes me downstairs. He's like, you like horror movies? He likes horror movies. You guys talk it out. Do something.
Yo, that was a great impression, by the way.
So I meet Paul. We keep in touch. I was like sending him scripts. He was telling me about projects. And when I sent him Anecdota, he was like, I want to do this project with you. So he came on and produced the project. And it was probably the best set experience I had in years. We just all got along great, even with COVID. My partner took the COVID compliance class, so we had everything, you know, up according to the SAG regulations of how, you know, everyone's got to be masked up, you got to fill out this paperwork, take your temperature, everyone's in their different zones, so no one can go near the talent. But we did all that, and we conquered it. So, you know, you could film during the pandemic and be okay, you know.
Yeah, well, I look forward to seeing that project, man. It sounds like it's going to be really dope.
Yeah, I'm excited for it. We'll definitely be keeping, I keep people posted as best as I can, you know, on the gram, I guess, is like your main.
Yeah, man. You said you're a big horror movie buff. What's your favorite horror movie of all time?
No, Halloween.
Halloween, yeah, that's one of mine too, actually.
Yeah.
Do you have any good, like, horror movie recommendations? Because I feel like I don't like a lot of horror movies. I find them to be corny.
Or any ones that came out recently,
right? Yeah, that's what I mean, like maybe more recent horror movies that I might have overlooked or we might have overlooked.
Yeah, there was, I mean, I don't know if you've seen Train to Busan.
No,
that's not super recent, but it's a Korean horror film. It's a zombie flick, and it's I call it the father-daughter horror movie because the main character is, it's a father-daughter story. So it's a beautiful movie. If you could deal with subtitles, you know, that's a great thing about horror. As far as like action movies and horror movies go, the reason why they work internationally, why our films sell so well from the horror and the action world, is that you don't need to understand language to know what's going on. Like, when you're watching a horror movie and they're creeping and they're like, some, you're like, you don't have to hear it. You know, they're in danger. And yeah, if something comes out, they need to fucking run. So German, Arabic, you know, it doesn't matter. And it's the same thing with action movies. You're following this guy, he's on a motorcycle, there's bullets flying over his head. He could open up his mouth and be like, you know, shit throws, you know, and it doesn't matter. He's getting chased, he's gonna get killed unless he goes and saves that girl. That's why drama, romantic comedies, and things that involve, they're dialogue driven, you know, it's not going to work when you go into Brazil and these people speak Portuguese.
Yeah,
they're not getting the lingo. So I watch a lot of horror movies. It's good to watch. So what I'm getting at is, for people who don't really like watching foreign films, watch a horror movie in foreign, because it's not going to bother you as much. You'll pick up on things a lot easier. It's so much easier to grasp and read through. So Train to Busan, I definitely recommend. And then I just watched another new zombie flick, which was, it might have been Korean as well. I think it might be called Alive, and it's a kid and the zombie apocalypse happens and he's in his apartment and he's in like a complex where there's a girl in the apartment across from him and they start communicating with one another. And that was another good zombie flick that I watched. And then this is maybe a gem that most people don't know about, but it's not brand new. You seen Let Me In?
No.
I think I might have seen it.
I don't think so.
For me, that's a must see. It was such a unique take on a story that we've been told 100 times. I'm not going to say what that story is, but it's about two young kids that live in an apartment complex and kind of find each other during turmoil. So there is the right one in is the Swedish version of it, and then Americans redid it with Chloe Moretz, who's the girl that was in like Kick-Ass 2, I think. And okay. She ended up playing Carrie in the Carrie reboot. But phenomenal acting, phenomenal writing, phenomenal visuals, a really good horror film to check out that you won't be like, this is corny.
Yeah, I'm going to check those out because, like I said, I've had trouble with horror movies all the time. I'm like, yeah, this sucks. You know,
and right now, I'm a huge James Wan fan. So anything that he does from the Conjuring series, he, you know, and you have to look at it. So he owns the Conjuring universe, but... that doesn't mean that he's making every film. Sometimes he's just a producer because they bought the property off him. So like out of those Annabelle movies, the first one that came out, which was probably called Annabelle, not that great. But Annabelle Creation, which was the prequel, was awesome. I like The Nun. That was good.
Yeah, I remember when that came out. Yeah, I haven't seen it though.
Conjuring 3's already been in the bag. Like, they've had that sitting. So Conjuring 1, Conjuring 2, I love. I can't wait to see Conjuring 3. That's been shot and edited, and I think they're just waiting for, you know, a release date, because they want to, you know, those have been massive global. Anything with religious tone to it, or religious, not sub, it's actually in it. It's like written into the script. Mm-hmm. That stuff sells really well in religious countries.
Really?
Yeah. Like, you, if you look at, I was studying, you know, international marketing of these horror movies, and the ones that had like The Nun and The Conjuring, the ones that have The Exorcist kind of feel to it, where it has that whole religious storyline that's going with it, they do really well in religious countries.
Wow. You would think those would be like sacrilegious movies, and religious people wouldn't want to watch them.
You think they wouldn't want to, right?
Right. Yeah.
But they want to see that.
Oh, no, that's cool. Yeah. I didn't know. I had no idea.
So my new movie, Priest Killer.
Oh, yeah. Word. All right.
Right into the market.
You had mentioned earlier that, you know, you were always interested in different cultures. Specifically, you said Albanian culture. Did you see the movie Albanian Gangster?
No, but I've been told. So.
Oh, you got to watch that, bro.
The people that do know me have told me, yo, you got to. Because I have a lot of Albanian friends here. And they're like, you haven't seen Albanian Gangster yet? And I guess the guy from right here in the Bronx that made the movie.
Yeah.
I need to see that movie. I'll say, shout out to Anissa. I managed an Albanian girl for many years. My guy picked her when she was on like one of these like these sites that you like sing, and they do covers, and they get really well promoted on Instagram. But that girl, Albanian wise, there's a lot of talent coming from Albania or Albanian descent. You've got Rita Ora. Mm-hmm. You've got, you know, this girl is killing it, and she's gonna be doing big things very soon.
It's definitely an interesting culture, man. They're very hardcore about their beliefs. And that movie was probably, I could probably say, the most realistic gangster or crime movie, at least as far as street stuff goes, that I've seen. I felt like I was there in the street with these guys when, you know, when I was watching the movie. I mean, from what I understand, they basically, that director just went to the Bronx and found people that, like the dude that's a main character, shout out to John. He's a cool dude too. I talked to him a little bit. He was just a street guy that did a bunch of jail time. And the director was like, hey, do you want to be in my movie? And I think they just, like, I don't know. It's very raw. You should definitely watch it.
I casted a couple of Albanians in Eulogy. One of them, the one clip that's online that you could see on my film, I'll send it to you, is a clip of someone that all of our brothers know, Cup Koopy.
I met him, I think, once or twice.
But Koopy's in Eulogy. Koopy's in Abaddon as well.
Okay.
And Koopy was a guy that I just, like, I'm looking at this guy's head and his face, and I'm just like, dude, you need to act. And, like, he's like, sure. So, funny little story with him. So, I casted everyone in Eulogy, and, you know, there's a lot of speaking. It's a drama. So, I had rehearsals one day at my friend's restaurant in Brooklyn. So, everyone was kind of coming. I had, like, hours blocked out where they'd come in and I'd work with them. So, first guy shows up, do the rehearsal. Second guy shows up, do the rehearsal. Third guy, and Koopy shows up, and he didn't have a script with him. I was like, oh, you don't have a script. I was like, I'll go print one up. I got my laptop, unless you want to read it off my laptop. He's like, I don't need a script. I'm like, are you serious? Like, I don't need a script. I'm like, all right, let's go. Sat down. He had every line. He was the only one. I love you, Kaves. I love Federico. I love everybody. But this dude came memorized. And if you know Robert Downey Jr. And his acting mythology, is like that the first thing you have to do is you have to memorize it to where you know exactly what's on the page, because then you can start creating that character. Mm-hmm. He goes, you have to have it memorized first before you can start creating the character. He goes, because the memorization has to be subconscious. You have to know each line subconsciously, and then you build and shape what this person is like, you know, with your inflection and all of your other things. So shout out to Koopy.
What did you think of The Irishman?
It was a good film. It's really tough for someone of that caliber to make a movie, because you have the expectations of every masterpiece that you've done before that. And while The Irishman is a good movie, it's not a masterpiece like he's done before.
Yeah.
You saw some amazing performances within it. I think Joe Pesci,
the best,
crushed it. I mean, he just came back with all the fire in the world. Shout out to Melissa Prophet, Joe Pesci's manager, who I've met and worked with over the years. And then the young gunner, who he's not even that young, but who played Tony Pro, the English actor.
Oh, he's really good. Yeah, Stephen Graham, right?
Graham.
Wow. Yeah, he's really good. He's a good actor.
These guys were just, they came to play. And, yeah. And while the script didn't, and I just didn't feel, you know what it is? I didn't see De Niro playing that role of Frank Sheeran.
I agree.
No, I think that Scorsese had a massive opportunity, and I'm not here to critique his work and say,
yeah, he's one of the greatest.
I love Martin Scorsese.
No doubt, absolutely.
If he told me I could pay him money to watch footage that he was about to throw out from stuff he didn't like, I would pay the money and watch the footage. That's how good I think he is. So, but I think he had an opportunity there to cast someone to play that role that would have been younger, a more up and coming actor, and he would have left everyone wowed. De Niro, I love De Niro. I love old De Niro. You know, he didn't leave me wowed. It was really hard to watch some of the scenes because they always say you got to keep the fish on the hook. You know, you can't let anybody know that this is a fantasy. And there are some amazing actors that do that. Leonardo DiCaprio, you never know you're watching Leonardo. You think he is every single character that he plays. He never lets you off the hook. You know, so De Niro, I was off the hook. I'm like, I'm watching Robert De Niro in a wardrobe with hair and makeup scene right now. And it just doesn't feel like, it didn't feel like Frank Sheeran. And I don't even know Frank Sheeran, but it didn't matter, you know?
About Al Pacino played Al Pacino.
I thought Al Pacino was pretty good, though, to be honest. I don't know.
He was pretty good. He wasn't Nicholson.
I've seen the movie years ago. I got to go back and watch it because a lot of people are like, that's the one that's the better of the two when it comes to actual realistic.
I mean, just depiction. You know, he crushed it. He's, but that was Nicholson at the top of his game. You know, this was Al Pacino, maybe a decade too late. Those guys are old, man. I know some young bucks gonna, if I become successful, they're gonna be like, that guy Don Capria is old. All right, hopefully I leave people with the legacy that those guys have left. They left, I grew up on those guys. I grew up on everything that Scorsese was making, and every year at the Oscars being like, please, this year, and he never got it until The Departed, but still another masterpiece that he did. You know, you look at Departed, that's the whole thing. You look at The Irishman and you want to go back to something. And I looked at The Departed right after that film and I'm just like, this is a masterpiece. This is a great movie. You know, that's the difference.
And yeah, I mean, you watch Casino, Goodfellas. I mean, it's just, it's not on the same level as those, I don't think.
I wonder if there will ever be a filmmaker as talented as Martin Scorsese to be able to pull off that trick, which was make Goodfellas and then make a movie that's it's almost sister film, and satisfy the audiences, the critics, and everyone with back-to-back films like that. Like, it was, what a challenge that is to, like, you know, that's like, you know, Jay-Z makes this amazing record with name somebody out there right now,
Kanye West,
right? And then they do this most amazing duet you've ever heard these two do, and it becomes the biggest hit in the world, and blah, blah, blah. I mean, like, worldwide success. And then a year later, he's like, I'm going to do one more song with Kanye. Everyone's going to be like, it's not going to add up to that one that those guys did. And they do it, and it's that freaking good. Again, you know, it's not difficult to match your last, big hit. And Scorsese did that, and I praise him for that. I never forget about stuff like that because he was at the top and he outdid himself. You know, I wouldn't say outdid himself. It wasn't like Casino to me, was like the better film. People, that's a preference thing when you're that good of a movie. But man, all the working components, from, Pesci stabbing bats in the trunk to Pesci putting guy's head in you fucking
amazing.
Pop his eye.
Wow. Wow.
Would you say Martin Scorsese is your favorite director of all time?
No.
Who's your favorite?
Man, this is gonna sound boring, but it might be Clint Eastwood.
Really? Yeah, he's a great director, though. He's made some great movies.
Yeah, I'm a really big Clint Eastwood fan. I love everything that dude has done, and he's done so much work. And I know some inside stories about him. My new director that I am completely enamored. I love all this dude's work. Denis Villeneuve.
Not familiar.
So Denis Villeneuve is out of Canada, and he's famous for Sicario.
Oh, great movie. Okay.
He did the new Blade Runner. He did Prisoners. He did
Prisoners was good.
What's the one that he's got a movie coming out now. Redid Dune. So
oh, cool.
He's gonna be a massive epic. But he did what my favorite Alien film ever made is Arrival, and he did that film.
Arrival's dope.
I haven't seen that, I don't think.
You would like it.
Yeah.
Yeah, Arrival, it tops every extraterrestrial movie I've ever seen. It was one finally where, like, you know, it's an hour and 40 minute movie, and then at the end they're like, oh my god, I just found out that if we shoot him in the chin, it's gonna kill them and we win. And then they go around, bup, 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 shoot the you know, like, just it's I've seen so many movies where it's just like it lacks the intel. It's like you're making a movie about a species of people that are coming to our planet from a different galaxy or a different dimension, so they're, you know, probably 1,000 times smarter than we are, but they forgot to wear their little helmet that protect, like, come on.
Yeah.
It's so
I don't think they had a early sci-fi where it was more communication based like that either.
No, you know? No. I mean, and I love the sci-fi thriller. I'm like, Alien is, you know, it's up there in my top five movies for sci-fi or horror. Mm. What a masterpiece that was. But, you know, I'm talking about, yeah, the more Contact style of movie where it's about, you know, just extraterrestrial beings and communicating how we would, what would happen, you know, like, you know, your Independence Day and all that kind of stuff, you know. But I get it. Hollywood's a machine and needs those poster movies where it's just, you know, a dude, he's like this, shit's blowing up in the background, and everyone's like, I'm going to see that, you know.
Did you see A Martian?
Yeah.
Yeah, that was dope too. It wasn't really a horror, but it was.
I haven't seen that.
It gets stuck.
My second one, which doesn't really touch on the extraterrestrial, but it's a space sci-fi movie, and it's one of my favorite films, is Interstellar.
Yeah, Interstellar's good too.
That movie does something to me every time I see it.
I haven't seen that either. I'm slacking on the sci-fi and horror genres right now.
I mean, anything by, I'll say this, you know, sci-fi, you want to see Blade Runner 2049, Denis Villeneuve, that movie is a masterpiece front to back.
I have to watch that. I like the old Blade Runner.
Yeah.
Old Blade Runner. A million years ahead of his time. And you said favorite directors. So, and probably in my top three right now is Clint Eastwood, Ridley Scott.
Yeah, Ridley Scott's good.
And I would say maybe Scorsese or Nolan, because Nolan hasn't done enough yet, but I really love Chris Nolan.
Nolan's
so, great. But Ridley Scott, man. That guy just, and he's still doing it. It's just, he's in, I think he's probably 80 years old now and he's still doing it. And same with Clint. Clint's still doing it. It's just crazy to me that these guys are just, that you could get better at that age without the young wit and the young, you know, the drive or the passion. And these guys are still making masterpieces.
Are you a Star Wars fan?
Yes.
Yeah, I just binged The Mandalorian the first two seasons, and now I've gone back and started watching all the Star Wars movies because I didn't really watch the sequels and really even the prequels, but I've gotten back into it the last couple of weeks.
Yeah, I loved it as a kid. You know, I was online for those movies as a kid, you know, with my mom, just like had all the toys. I'm totally obsessed with it. I didn't like what they did with, you know, what was it? So it was 4, 5, and 6. Then they did 1, 2, 3, or 4. I forget what the order went, but that was that 1, 3 series.
Oh, the prequels you're talking about?
Yeah, I think it was the prequels.
Yeah, they didn't get great reviews. But I like the sequels though. I think the sequels were well done.
Once they started coming back in recent years, like I loved Rogue One.
Rogue One was good too.
You know, Solo Story was cool. Like a lot of them are cool, but Rogue, I think it was. Was Rogue One at the end where they, or was it at the new Star Wars movie where the ending is the beginning of A New Hope, where like Vader comes through and they're like shooting at him? And what's that movie?
That's Rogue One. That was Rogue One. I just watched that the other night.
When that happened, I jumped in my seat. I remember I didn't watch that one in the theater. I was at home. I jumped in my couch like, holy fuck. And I think I was with a girl and like, she had never seen, you know, she's just looking at me like, what the fuck is this thing doing? I was like, you know, you have no idea. My head was exploding and she's just looking at me like, what the fuck? You know, like, this ain't Game of Thrones, chill out.
What's your favorite TV series of all time?
Game of Thrones up until the last season.
I never got into Game of Thrones.
You know, that was an abortion, but, favorite TV series. I'm gonna go out on a limb and say Dark.
Okay, I don't think I've seen that.
It's a German TV show. It would kind of be like, I always say to people, it's like Stranger Things if Chris Nolan wrote and directed it.
Okay, cool. I'm gonna have to look into that. I'm always looking for new stuff to watch, so I haven't seen that.
Especially now.
Don, you're a Sopranos fan, right?
Big Sopranos fan.
Yeah, man, one of the greatest. This guy watches The Sopranos on repeat, on loop. Yeah,
pretty much.
Probably watched it 25 times.
Yeah, I love that show. I think that's one of the most brilliantly written and executed shows ever in the history of television. If not, it is. And then David Chase, you know, the brilliance of that to me, and you step back and you look at it and it's like, they just started writing those characters. Those characters just started coming to life more and more and more and more. And they were just so, the talent that they were working with and the passion that the people who got involved with that project brought to the table. There was something very family, neighborhoody about, you know, clicky about that whole movement. And you could see it. It was in everything that they did. There was no one that didn't want to be there. You know, you could just tell it was a movement that it was a party. It was just a giant party that everyone was so proud to be a part of that they put in 110%. And I love that show. You know, it's great.
The character development is like the best.
Ever. Yeah, it's incredible. Yeah. Very well written.
Yeah. Amazing. And amazing. So many people came from that show. You know, there's a lot of writers, a lot of directors, you know, the ins and outs, and even, you know, I like the ending. I'm very good. You know, look, stuff's got to end, and I'll call it if it's, you know, bogus or this or that. You know, everyone's always going to challenge something. There's you know, hater born every minute. So I thought the ending was good. I thought they, you know, they left you with a question of, you know, what is next, and is he
going to? What do you think happened?
I think he's just going to keep being the gangster until
you don't think he gets killed.
No,
Rob here thinks he gets assassinated at the end. I don't really think that.
I love the sense of danger that they placed in there. But like, you know, is it really it? Is that really it for him right there, that moment in front of his wife and kids? Would mobsters do like that in front of his wife and kids? You know, that was always my biggest argument with the Joe Colombo shooting, is that I'll always say to someone, just to challenge them on theory, is name another time a gangster was murdered in front of women and children on a sanctioned
hit. Yeah, good point.
You know? It doesn't happen. And there's a reason it doesn't happen, because they have rules.
Right.
You may not want to believe and understand that they actually have rules in place that they follow, but they do. Because you don't believe it doesn't mean it's not true, you know? So with The Sopranos, I go back to that the fact that they wouldn't just whack him in front of his, you know, like he's going to walk outside and they're going to kill him, you know? But I love the tension. I agree with it. They're saying something's going to happen to him, you know? But I think the real tragedy of Tony Soprano is that he just continues to struggle, you know?
Yeah, maybe he got arrested. I mean, maybe it was the feds ran in there. You said that before.
Well, I thought that they were gonna have the hit on Tony. And then when the bell rang to come in, you thought it was Meadow, but I thought it would have been like Agent Harris coming in to like pull him out or stop it or something.
And that would have been great, you know, like the thing about that is like, there's probably a plethora of good endings that could have been, like Game of Thrones.
Like, you might've left it like that on purpose too, you know?
Yeah, I think they did. I think, you know, I like open endings. Right. I feel like we don't always need to, you know, as when you're reading, you know, you're fed so much information, but when you see a script, it's only a little bit of information, right? So that you can go ahead and create that on set. Mm-hmm. And I think with story, it's important to like allow people to be smart enough to kind of create stuff as we're going as well. You don't have to tell them everything. You don't have to spoon feed them all the answers. And I think he did that. I think he had spent years and years cultivating and developing these characters. And now he said, you know what? I'm going to let the fans finish this.
Word. Yeah. What's your favorite gangster movie of all time?
Oh, it's going to sound boring, but The Godfather.
Yeah. Which one do you, one or two?
I like both, but I think I always go to put on one first, just because of Brando. And I love De Niro. I love all that stuff, the backstory and everything, but Godfather 1. But I've put out, you know, recently, I think on the page, I was on the Colombo page on Instagram, and I was just like dropping as many gangster flicks for people to watch during the quarantine. And there was a couple of gems in there. Let me pull up some of my faves.
What about The Godfather 3? You a fan of that one?
I did not see the re-edit yet. But so for movies that I would tell someone to go watch, Even though there's no historical significance to it at all, American Gangster with Denzel Washington.
Okay, good movie.
The Drop, written by
Gandolfini's last movie, right?
Yep. Gomorrah, which the television series from my buddy Peter Conti, I heard, is amazing.
Great show. Great. Have you seen that?
No, I didn't see it yet.
Oh, you got to watch it, man. It's great.
I did watch a couple episodes of 000.
That's a great show, too. Yeah, yeah.
Eastern Promises.
Yeah, that's a good one, too.
If you've missed that film, you're missing out. Sicario, because I believe it's a gangster film. Like even
Yeah, definitely.
It's and then the George Higgins novel, The Friends of Eddie Coyle.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
So if you've seen The Town, I think Ben was really moved and inspired by The Friends of Eddie Coyle when he made that movie. So Leon the Professional is one of my faves.
Oh, yeah.
Copland, because those guys are a gang too. That one was Stallone, De Niro, and everybody. I liked Black Mass. I loved Fargo. I liked The Town. Another one that people sleep on, Road to Perdition.
Great movie.
You know, 1920s. I think that's a good handful of all those films.
You ever seen Miller's Crossing?
Oh, hell yeah.
Coen Great Brothers. Movie. Coen Brothers, right?
Amazing.
Legend.
Another one that slept on. I met John Turturro in a pizzeria.
Really?
I was sitting down eating. I was had a music artist in Lower East Side in a studio, so I took a break to go eat. I was going to go to Luzzo and eat a whole pizza pie in my head. So sitting down, I text my buddy who was in Texas at the time. I'm like, yo, I'm at our spot. And he's like, oh, shit. And I'm like, John Turturro just walked in. He's at the bar having a glass of wine. He's like, you're a pussy if you don't go get a picture with him right now and send it to me. I'm not going to bother the guy. He's having a glass of wine, you know, blah, blah, blah. He's like, you're a pussy. He goes, don't even text me no more. He goes, the only time you could text me again, we could talk again, is when you send me a picture, you and John Turturro. So you're either going to make it happen now or we're not going to talk for a long time. So I walk up. I said, hey, Mr. Turturro. I was like, I want you to know, it's a pleasure to meet you. I'm a big fan of all your movies. And he's like, oh, that's very nice. He, you know, and his friend had joined him at this point. And he's like, I was like, look, I don't want to bother you too much. He's like, but I'd really love to take a picture with you. And I don't want to tell him my friend was calling me, you know.
Yeah.
So he's like, yeah, sure. Let's take a picture. So boom, take the picture. I said, yeah, because I want to say one more thing. I said, I know you're from Brooklyn. And I know you're from near Diker. I said, I wrote a book about a guy from Brooklyn. And he's like, you wrote a book about a guy from Brooklyn? I said, yeah, I wrote Joe Colombo's life story with Anthony Colombo, his oldest son. He goes, you wrote Joe Colombo's life story? I said, yeah. He goes, my brother's reading your book right now. I'm reading it next.
Wow, that's dope,
like,
man.
Shit, Mr. Turturro's reading my book. Like, oh.
That's the universe at work, bro. That's dope, man. Hey, maybe they'll pick it up. They'll say, yo, let's make a movie out of this.
Yeah.
John Turturro, you know?
Yeah, I gotta find out who his agent is.
That'd be dope, man.
Send him over a pie from Luzzo, a glass of wine.
Now, real quick, as an author, who's like an author that inspired you, or writers and stuff like that?
I mean, I used to read a lot of fiction. So I was, you know, big into Patterson and the guy in Louisiana, who's the guy who wrote The Partner and all that stuff. Oh my God, my brain. Who wrote The Partner? Who wrote Pelican Brief?
Is that, oh, it's a fiction, right? I don't know.
Yeah. John Grisham.
Okay.
I read like every John Grisham book. I read all Puzo's books. I loved Puzo as a writer. Even though everyone was like, ah, that was shit. Fools Die, all that. I loved Puzo's books. But I read a lot of nonfiction. I was reading a lot of nonfiction.
No.
In my later years, like I said, I started reading all the crime books.
Mm-hmm.
You know, everyone from like Philip Carlo to Selwyn Rabb. And I just started getting my own imagination and stories based on, like I said, when I made Eulogy, the core story of the brother doing time for that's something that I read. It's a real piece of history that I dramatized. So a lot of the stuff that I write about comes from nonfiction. And then I go ahead and I dramatize the situation. Like think about Anecdota, right? I'm writing Anecdota about a 10-year-old girl trapped in a building. There's really a pandemic happening. Society really started to lash out when the civil unrest started happening for people and poverty started becoming poverty is a very real thing again right now. And it's a very evil thing. So we're starting to see people act up in ways that we've never seen, not at least in this lifetime. And I wanted to write a story about that, you know, And as I get further into this story of Anecdota, you know, we're going to examine a little bit more of the civil unrest and how people, because ultimately those zombie movies, when you're really talking about it, it's not the zombies who are, the zombies are like Bin Laden, you know, like they incite an incident and make people change the way they're living. And then people destroy each other, you know?
Oh, yeah, good point. Yeah, yeah, it usually happens, right? When they're in the zombie movies, the people turn against each other and shit.
It's happening right now in this country.
That's it. You know, like there's an inciting incident, right? It's like, you know, we set a fire, we open up a door, throw it in a room, and we, you know, the people who set the fire are watching the people in that room, how they deal with it, you know, and then someone bounces the fire off me onto the other person. He's like, fuck you. And next thing you know, mayhem, chaos, disorder, you know.
If you were stranded on an island and could listen to one album, what would it be?
Yeah. The Cure, Disintegration.
Okay.
Yeah. Gotta go there.
I like The Cure. Cure's dope.
I fuck with The Cure heavy. I'm on like real vibey stuff when I write. I can't have too much stuff going on when I have music. Sometimes it's even classical music. There can't be too much going on. It has to be kind of ethereal and like ambient, you know. So I write a lot to like The Cure and like 80s stuff that's like kind of mellow and vibey.
So you don't put on Slayer and just start writing horror?
No. Like open push-ups and the heat goes on at a Slayer or something. More Sepultura lately.
Yeah, Sepultura is dope.
Yeah.
Why don't you give out your social media, your website, where people can reach you and promote anything else that you got going on?
Yeah, I mean, I put everything through my page. So my name, Don Capria, is the easiest way to find me and the things that I do. I have a film company page. There's a page for the Colombo book. If you would like to buy my book, you can go to Amazon and you could type in Colombo, The Unsolved Murder, which is the title of the book.
That's great book.
It's green, white, and red because the Italian flag is green, white, and red. So it's pretty easy to identify. And then I don't really have a YouTube channel or any of that kind of stuff. I really live and breathe on Instagram. I love the app.
Probably the best one. My favorite.
Yeah. I love taking pictures. You know, I hate seeing the hate on there, but I'll deal with it until it starts going away. But haters gonna hate, you know.
You know what they say? They say the more hate you get, the more that you'll be promoted and pushed in the algorithms.
Oh, 100%. Yeah, that's definite. I used to say that, you know, with there's one band, Concrete Dream. Shout out to those guys. Yep. I've been working with them for a few years, developing them, and they got promoted on a page, and the kids were filling up the comments with a bunch of hate. I said, good, because now your post is gonna be really popular. I was like, and if you reach, you know, that. People don't understand that there is an actual, there's a percentage rate that you want to reach, right? So like, let's say you have 100% of the people you reach and 30% of those people are very vocal because they hate you. If that promotes you and out of that 100% of the people, 20% of the people become your fans, that's all you care about. You care about the 20 percentile. Now that 20 percentile doesn't have a number attached to it. So the more you get promoted and the more people you get in front of, the more of that 20 percentile you get to take home with you.
Word.
The 30% are the people that are doing the work for you. They're the ones that are vocal. Mm. They fucking hate. The 20% may not say a word. They might just keep quiet and just follow you and start listening to more music. Be like, I like these guys. But man, that 30%, you owe them a paycheck because they're blowing your shit up. So, you know, you've got to look at the metrics on everything and try to realize that. And I always tell that to bands, like, you know, you really got to just be doing stuff and promoting stuff, even with the hate comment, doesn't matter. There's a small group of people in each one of your Instagram posts, each one of your music videos, each one of the comment sections of your YouTube and so on and so forth that you're looking to impress. And those are the ones that you have to keep chasing, and they want more content from you, but you know, the hate will help you get in front of more people for sure.
Yeah. Let the haters hate. I think that's the lesson.
Yeah.
Fuck it.
Yeah, a form of flattery.
They're gonna bring you more attention, you know. Talk shit about increase your fan base.
I just posted a picture yesterday or whatever. Please go talk shit about me, especially on my Colombo page.
Everyone follow Don Capria on Instagram and fucking fill his page up with nothing but hate. Go to the Colombo page, do the same thing. Just talk a bunch of shit. That's what we need. That's what fuels the fire.
Yep.
Well, Donnie, thank you for coming on, bro. Yeah, that was great, man. That was really good. Everyone, make sure you get the Colombo book. Make sure you follow Don Capria and check out all the stuff that he has going on. A man of many talents.
Thank you for having me, fellas.
Of course, brother, man. We will talk soon. Thank you.
Street Corner Soapbox, we're fucking out of here.
Peace.
The Street Corner Soapbox. The Street Corner Soapbox.
If you're a fan of the podcast, you can help support the show by donating to our PayPal at paypal.me/streetcorner.